Back on June 5th, I went to a St. Tammany Parish Council meeting, and I went there because I had heard that they were going to be discussing the possibility of an oil company coming in to drill a well about 3 miles that way, and it would include the possibility of fracturing. Now, being 3 miles that way, it meant that if they fracture, which means they can go this way, it would probably end up underneath my house, so that kind of concerned me a little bit. Anyway, at that meeting, I heard a number of people speak, and frankly, was so blown away by the quality of the speakers and their passion and what they had to say, both intellectually as well as emotionally, that in my own little way, I kind of thought everybody should have been there. Everybody in the parish should have been there to hear what these folks had to say, because frankly, I feel like they represented a pretty good cross-section. There were people from all walks of life there, not professional politicians, not spokespeople, just regular people, your friends and neighbors, who felt compelled to get up and say something to the parish council in regards to what they felt like this kind of heavy industry would do to the parish. So I've done this little small series, and I've interspersed clips. I've gone to visit these folks in their homes and tried to do little interviews. I'm not a professional journalist or anything like that. I just wanted to try to capture people sort of on their home turf, get a behind-the-scenes look at what makes them tick so that we can all kind of realize that, you know, we're all in this together. They're just you and me. Neighbors that are concerned about clean air, clean water, healthy children, and a good, safe place to raise families and run businesses. Anyway, this is the third in my video series, and it is Professor Maurice Dupree, who I found fascinating, and I'm very excited to share with you because he has an extraordinary way of being able to take all these big numbers that people keep throwing around, gazillions of gallons of this and cubic yards of that. And he has a way of getting it down into reality and pictures. So I hope you enjoy it and look forward to your feedback. And you better take notes because I understand there could be a test.
And I'm a math professor at Tulane, and I've been there for over 40 years, basically doing mathematical research in theoretical physics, never anything applied, and never really was concerned about anything very environmental until this whole fracking thing came up.
How did you get concerned? How did you find out about it? How did you get
concerned? Well, I had basically heard in the news people being upset with their drinking water contaminated in Pennsylvania, and there had been problems with scuffle seemed like it wasn't a good thing. I thought I'd better look into it when I found out it was coming here, because this is the last place I ever expected to have to deal with that. Mm-hmm. And I found out pretty quickly that right off the bat, there's enormous amounts of toxic wastewater that comes out of hydraulic fracturing. And consequently, I immediately, rang up a red flag, wanted to look into seeing, well, what are these numbers mean? And it's not like all this wastewater is out in totally remote areas, such as the case for ordinary mining operations, even coal mining operations and so forth. This is now being brought right into our backyards, literally. And consequently, when you think about, well, all this wastewater has to be trucked in and out here and there. Every time some trucker decides, has to empty his wastewater into something or pick up wastewater, you've got connections being made. There are all these opportunities for spills. So, for instance, if you imagine that, only 1 out of 1,000 parts are spilled, 1/1000th of 280 billion is still 280 million gallons of toxic wastewater being spilled around, people or, places where it's getting into contaminating actual environment that we live in, as opposed to way out in the middle of nowhere. So recently, I started really paying attention. I mean, the possibility that we could handle that level of wastewater without having a significant fraction of it get into our environment and then eventually work its way into our aquifer. It's just not believable.
As a research mathematician, I would just like to make you all aware of the magnitude of the wastewater problem that the fracking presents. All the nuclear reactors in the history of the United States over the entire history of the nuclear program would fit in a swimming pool the size of a football field 30 feet deep. The wastewater for 10 fracking wells would fill that. The current fracking operation could go to 600 wells on the property out there at 1088, which would be 60 times the volume of all the radioactive waste in the history of the United States. The fracking wastewater, in a sense, is maybe even more dangerous because it's full of unknowns. The EPA list of toxic chemicals that are in that fracking water contains many chemicals that the EPA does not even really know how dangerous they are. They only make guesses to set the maximum tolerance. So consequently, we're going into the dark here by allowing this. We really need to keep in mind that this is a very, very serious situation. Thank you.
Thank you.
One of the things that these companies have been doing is, and of course the industry, chemical industry in general, has been using injection wells to indefinite store chemical wastes of all kinds. Well, it's turning out that these injection wells we're finding often develop leaks a lot more than people ever thought they would. Mm-hmm. You have to realize a lot of the practices of the oil industry has just kind of evolved over time through experience. So when we start dealing with things like injection wells, people don't really know what the result's going to be. What they sometimes do is use computer models, and these computer models depend on assumptions, and try out various assumptions in the computer models and see what happens. And so they're led to believe by their experience and their computer models that everything's going to be okay. Well, it's turning out that actual experience and experimental results is showing that things are not always okay. For instance, it's recently been found that sometimes these chemicals get out of these wells, through cracks, breaks, whatever, and migrate distances in a few weeks maybe that their theories and ideas led them to believe would take 10,000 years. You've got a real problem here if something's getting a significant distance away in a few days that you thought was going to take 10,000 years. One of the other things that these companies have been doing is, and of course the industry, chemical industry in general, has been using injection wells to indefinite store chemical wastes of all kinds. Well, it's turning out that these injection wells we're finding often develop leaks a lot more than people ever thought they would. Mm-hmm. You have to realize a lot of the practices of the oil industry has just kind of evolved over time through experience. So when we start dealing with things like injection wells, people don't really know what the result's going to be. What they sometimes do is use computer models, and these computer models depend on assumptions, and try out various assumptions in the computer models and see what happens. And so they're led to believe by their experience and their computer models that everything's going to be okay. Well, it's turning out that actual experience and experimental results is showing that things are not always okay. For instance, it's recently been found that sometimes these chemicals get out of these wells, they, you know, through cracks, breaks, whatever, and migrate distances in a few weeks, maybe, that their theories and ideas led them to believe would take 10,000 years. Titian, I know how the academic world works. So when I find things on the internet, I can research them, I can use academic search engines to actually track down academic papers and see what the science actually says. There are cases where environmentalists have, for instance, exaggerated the claims that have been made, and this is unfortunate. But now we're actually dealing with real facts. For instance, two scientists at the University of Texas at Arlington in the chemistry department started investigating the methane, ethane, and other chemicals in the Barnett Shale and in the drinking water wells, and found a very strong correlation between the nearness of wells to the hydrofracking operations, very strong correlation, and the amount of contaminants in the drinking water well. And it's true that some of the contaminants didn't show correlation, but significant contaminants did show correlation. And then recently they announced that they had done an isotopic analysis, which is like a DNA fingerprint of the ethane-methane mixture found in the drinking water wells, is virtually identical to the methane-ethane mixture in the Barnett Shale. Now, the aquifer that they're using there is about a mile above the Barnett Shale. And so this ethane-methane mixture, which is in the drinking water, which correlates, the amount in the drinking water correlates with distance from the hydrofracking wells, showing the high indication that it was coming from the hydrofrack operations, is now shown, like fingerprinted, to actually be coming from the Barnett Shale. So consequently, you have to conclude now that it's definitely the hydrofracking operations that caused that. And this is in contradiction of everything that the science, the industry scientists thought could possibly happen.
Right.
So.
That sounds like quite a smoking gun.
Yes, this exactly is, in my opinion, the smoking gun. Just think in terms of numbers. The hydraulic fracturing waste volume is so enormous that it should be clear to anyone that we can't handle it. We certainly don't have the regulatory assets to do it. And if you simply combine that with the fact that very recently the legislative auditor declared our regulating agencies to be basically incompetent, and you see we've got a real problem, and then the waste volume is several orders of magnitude beyond what you'd be dealing with nuclear waste. And it's extremely frustrating. And, you know, all these years I've never had to deal with it. You know, you hear about it and it just kind of like water off a duck's back. You know, it doesn't affect me. But now it's really affecting me. And it really makes me angry.
We're going into the dark here by allowing this. We really need to keep in mind that this is a very, very serious situation.